judgment and fury and indignation, you shall devour the adversaries. That's where you're headed. You walk away through Christ, that's where you're going. And he gives an example. Even this wise Moses walked by without mercy under two or three witnesses. Verse 29. Of how much sore punishment? How much more severe will the punishment be? Suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God and hath counted the blood of the covenant whereby he was sanctified a holy thing and have been bespied into the spirit of grace? Or somebody that tramples the blood of Christ underfoot, the punishment will be extremely severe. Coming back, you won't forsake in that first verse. If we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, you know, if somebody walks away from Christ after they have come face to face with the truth, the writer says, how much more severe, how much sore is that punishment? Do you suppose it might be? And for that person who had trodden out of foot the Son of God, that God had brought the covenant where he was sanctified, the holy thing had been displayed under the spirit of grace. He has rejected all of that. Verse 30. For we know him that has said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord, and again, the Lord shall judge his people. Verse 31. It's a fearful thing to fall under the hands of the living God. The writer of Hebrews noted the seriousness of trampling underfoot the blood. That's why it's not applied to the threshold. The blood is to be respected, it's holy. It's to be respected, that's what I have on the next paragraph here. Man is called upon not to disrespect the blood of the Lamb of God. When man knows of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for him, if he makes the choice to continue to live in sin, he's on a path that is taking him directly into the heat of God's judgment. This man's judgment will be far more intense and severe than the person who dies in their sins and has never been exposed to the gospel. The person's judgment will be far more severe. Let me back that up. Habakkuk 12:46-48 says this. Says the Lord, that servant will come to him and he looketh not for him in an hour when he's not aware. He will cut him in sunder and will bring him his portion with the unbelievers. And that servant, which knew his Lord's will, prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. And he that knew not, he did commit such things worthy of stripes, shall be beaten with few stripes. For unto whomsoever much is given of him shall be much required, and to whom men have committed much of him, they will ask the more. Let me read the last line of the chapter. Someone that turns from Jesus Christ is the trampled foot. The sacred blood is shed for their sins. And so that makes them, that raises them up to a higher level of accountability. And then when people die in their sins, and whenever they finally end up as in Revelation chapter 20, into the lake of fire at the great white throne judgment, what you need to understand is that just like in heaven, there are different degrees of rewards. In the lake of fire, there will be different degrees of punishment that will be handed out. And one of the things that will be determined, well, that will be used to determine that, is right here, the amount of knowledge, the amount of truth that that person is exposed to, the opportunities that they have had unto, frankly, whosoever much is given of them shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much of them, they will ask the more. The more that an individual knows, the more severe that punishment will be. So for somebody to come right up to the cross, right up to the cross, right up to almost accepting Christ and saying thanks but no thanks and turning and walking away, their degree of punishment if they die in their sins will be far more intense than somebody that has never had that opportunity before. There's the protection there of the blood, and we have the application of the blood. Watch verse 22. I'll read this again. You shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin. You strike the lintel on the two sides with the blood that is in the basin, and out of you shall go out at the door of the house until the morning. Let me read what I have on your paper. The blood of the lamb was to be applied with hyssop. Hyssop was a small plant with stiff branches and soft, hairy, like leaves, which would work, since it worked as a brush to apply the blood. The hyssop is often mentioned in the Bible with certain sacrifices. I'm going to show you that, okay? You times you take this, there's other references mentioned in Leviticus 14, 1 through 7. Since the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, this shall be the law of the leper in the day of his cleansing. He shall be brought unto the priest, and the priest shall go forth out of the camp. The priest shall look, and behold, if the plague of leprosy be healed in the leper, then shall the priest come in and take for him that is to be cleansed, two birds alive and clean, and cedar wood and scarlet, and hyssop there as he can. And the priest shall command that one of the birds be killed in an earthen vessel of running water, as for the living bird, he shall take it in the cedar wood and the scarlet, and the hyssop, and shall dip them and the living bird in the blood of the bird that was killed of the running water, and he shall sprinkle upon him that is to be cleansed from leprosy. Seven times he shall pronounce him clean, and shall let the living bird loose into the open field. So the hyssop is connected to the application of the blood. Watch what David wrote whenever he needed to be cleansed. Psalm 51, 2 through 7, watch what he wrote. He said, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight. That thou mayest be justified when thou speakest and declare when thou judgest. Behold, I was shaken in iniquity and sin, that thy mother conceived me. Behold, thou desirest truth in inward parts and in the hidden part. Thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. What's the last line that I have there? David apparently had the idea of using the hyssop to apply the blood to himself for the cleansing. So when you read of this, the hyssop is used to put it on. It's connected with the sacrifices, but there's more to it. Watch the application. The hyssop being a small plant speaks of humility. Using it to apply the blood speaks of faith. These are two things which are essential for salvation. In order for someone to be saved, they must humble themselves and confess they are a sinner. Humility in a person is something that is very rare. Most people refuse, or most people confess, in order for someone to be saved, they must humble themselves and confess they are a sinner. Humility in a person is something that is very rare. Most people refuse to see their true sinful condition. Most people have a difficult time admitting that they are not able to save themselves. You see, the majority of people trust in their own righteousness to get them to heaven. That's what they're trusting in. So humility and brokenness is a very rare thing. It's a very rare thing. The hyssop being a small plant speaks of humility, and that's what's needed. Humility is needed whenever it comes to salvation. But it is rare that you see that in an individual's life. I've talked to many people, and I've asked them, if you died today, why would God let you into heaven? And a lot of times I get the answer, because I'm a pretty good person, I've done this or I've done this. They're trusting in self-righteousness. A person must be humbled. They must come to a state of humility and understand that they are a sinner. They cannot save themselves. They have to come to the end of themselves before they can be saved. So vitally important. Let me show you what this is. A bigger thing. I think you see that in Matthew 7, 13, and 14. Jesus said, "Enter in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Few. And then you read these words in Luke 13, 4, that kind of compound on top of that. Jesus said this: "Strive to enter in at the straight gate. For many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able to. Why not? What will they be able to do? What will they be able to do? It is the gate. What will they be able to do? Because they are trusting in their own self-righteousness. That's not going to work. It's not going to work. You know, we've talked about what is the gates. The black gate is all going to back you up. The just walk on this path. They could carry through the world. They could carry their self-righteousness. There's room for that there. But it's that, in verse 14, that straight gate, that narrow gate, it's like a tourist style at an airport. You can't get through it with a bunch of luggage. You can't force your way through it because it's too narrow. It's too narrow. Because Jesus says this, we have to come with nothing. We have to come with nothing. And that's why he says back here in Luke 13:24, strive to enter into the straight gate. He's not saying you gotta work for it. But the idea is that it is hard for an individual to come to the end of themselves, to come to a point where they say, oh, Lord, I don't have anything to offer. I got nothing to offer. And that's what it takes. It takes a person that is under the conviction of the Spirit of God that says, I got nothing at all whatsoever to offer. I got nothing to give. That person is ready to enter in through that narrow gate. But it's rare that that ever happens in an individual's life. That's why Jesus said that door that the, I'm going to back you up again, that's why Jesus said that the gate is straight or narrow, and the way is narrow, that they come to life and few there be that find it. And say that few there be that find it. Come back to the top of page 4, and we'll be right where we are today. Many will seek to enter in where they are able, because they're trusting in their own self-righteousness. Humility is essential to salvation. His present wisdom comes out of the conviction of the Holy Spirit and accepts the truth of their loss and their sins. So this happens with the gate of salvation. For if this is not the attitude of the sinner, then the city is exercising faith in their own righteousness. When they are able to bear the conviction of the Spirit, they are ready to exercise faith in the finished work of Christ. So this thought speaks of humility and it speaks of faith upon the moment. Listen, you think of the faith that night. Now, do you think about this? That we've already witnessed 9 plagues. We've already watched what happened. We watched the destruction. Remember what the Pharaoh's men said? Is that Egypt is destroyed. And we're talking to Pharaoh like a poor man, but you know what in paradise? Egypt is destroyed. Israel watched that. They watched the blood turn to, or the river turn to blood. They watched the fish die. They watched that. They watched the flies. They watched the lice that came. They watched the hail that fell. They heard the thunder. In the experience, they watched those plagues. They knew what was going on. And so now they hear this. Okay, here's what's going to happen this night. The firstborn in every house is going to die. The firstborn in every house is going to die. There's 1 means of protection. The blood of a lamb. Really? I'm supposed to trust in the blood of an animal being in the right door. Think about that. And you and I read that. And we just take it for granted. You can apply the blood. It's different if you're the firstborn. It's different when if you're looking at your children. It's different if your wife is the firstborn. Because the second is going to happen, and you know it's going to happen. You've already watched nine of them unfold. And now you're only 10 minutes. This one, and maybe this one includes you. And because maybe you're the firstborn in the family. And so now, you're listening for a lot. We got to escape this. And Moses said, you're going to just. You're going to kill a lamb. You're going to take his blood. And you're going to put it on the side post of the door and the lintels over top of the door. God, I tell you this today. You wouldn't have ever slept. You wouldn't have slept that night. The way in the world. You would have done this. There's no other means. If we did this, the humility in another way. There's something better than to take this precious life off and dip it in the blood of a lamb and paint it on the door. There's something better that we can do. No. Just do what God tells you to do. Then trust in the blood. So they hear now that when the legacy we read, Jew and Boyer, right over top of it. And we don't stop. Assyria to smite the Egyptians and receive from them upon the land that you sent us. Lord, will pass over the door, and not suffer the destroyer to come on your houses to smite you. The people who take her hand to the houses, it was the blood and I, the blood that would keep Israel safe from the judgment of God. Why is there something a little bit different now? I want to kind of branch off here and look at a few things. Most applications are just to look into the Word of God and see the power and the blood. I don't know if you've ever walked through and stick out up at some of the verses to see what the blood does. Number one is this: the blood provides life. Genesis 9, 1 through 4, let me read this. Okay, this is when Noah gets off the ark. It says, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, and the fear of you and every man of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl of the air, and upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand will be delivered every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you, even as the green herb, have I given you all things. But the flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. Noah was given permission to be able to eat flesh after the flood, because the flesh had to be cooked. You couldn't eat the body and the flesh, because here was the deal. The life was in the blood. Listen to this. There's a tremendous message in that. The life was in the blood, and none of us are worthy of life. None of us are. We're worthy of life. Because we're all sinners. But the fact that God permitted them to be able to kill the animals and to be able to eat them, there's a message in that. And that message is this: that in order for man to survive, something had to die. Something innocent had to die. In order for us to survive physically, something's got to die. In order for us to survive spiritually, something has to die. Something's got to die. I'm going to watch this. Noah was given permission to eat meat and not the blood. The life of the flesh was in the blood. Only had a self-worthy life to kill an animal and consume. The flesh was designed to be a reminder that in order for man to live, something innocent must die. We're reminded of it every time we sit down and eat a steak. That something had to die in order for me to survive. Now, watch this. We see this in Leviticus with a little bit more information, Leviticus 17, 10 and 11. And whatsoever man or man of the house of Israel, of the strangers that sojourn among you, that eateth any man of blood, I will even set my face against that soul that eateth blood, I will cut him off from among his people. For the life of the flesh is in the blood. And I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh the atonement for the soul. Watch what I have written in this next paragraph. The blood was given as an atonement for the soul, which means the blood gives spiritual life. When the soul is saved, we are given new life. The blood of the Passover lamb gave life to the firstborn, just as we are given eternal life to the blood of the Lamb of God. The blood provides life. It gave life to the firstborn that night when Israel was in Egypt. It was the blood that gave the life. It spared the judgments of the blood, in a sense, gave the life. In the same way, whenever the blood is applied to you and I, we receive eternal life. So the blood gives life. The next one, the blood provides redemption. Revelation 5:9, watch this. And he said unto his son, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred, tongue, and people, and nation. We are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Watch right now if you watch the paragraph. To redeem means to purchase. Redemption often took place in a realm of slavery. Slaves were often sold in public auctions. The price that was paid for a slave was the redemption. If a man chose to, he could buy a slave and set him free, or he could keep him and use him as a worker on his property. If the slave was out of the extreme, the price for the slave would be high. We were slaves to sin. We were not able to get free of our own. We were spiritually bankrupt, so we could not pay the price of redemption. We were sinners, we were dishonorable. But God has always made the choice to redeem us and to set us free. The price he paid was the highest cost of all, for it was the blood of his only son. The price for our sin debt was far too high to pay with silver and gold, so that we could be something that was valuable. Paid out our redemption would be paid with the precious blood of the Lamb. Understand this, that silver and gold couldn't do it because it wasn't valuable enough. 1 Peter 1:18-19 Peter says this, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, for your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, but of thought. That was you and I were so deep in the sin that there was only one way to buy us out. And what is it? We weren't even lovable people. We weren't even people that had value whatsoever. We were nobodies. We were nobodies that, as I said this morning, we were empty clay pots. We were not to absolutely nothing. We were the enemies of God. We were sinned against God. We worked against God. And in the midst of all of that, God chose to love us. And he redeemed us with the most valuable thing that ever existed. That was the blood of his son, Jesus Christ. He redeemed us. He bought us. Watch what I have the last paragraph. So it was the blood of Jesus Christ that was paid our redemption. Now we're free. Free to live a life that is pleasing to God. This was impossible before we were saved. For we were slaves to sin, and that was all we knew. It was nothing good in us. So we could not only glorify God with our lives, but now we can. For now we're free. We've been redeemed, and God provides redemption. We have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Number three, actually, what else the Bible says? The blood provides justification. Romans 5:9, watch this. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. So listen, we receive life by the blood. We are redeemed by the blood. Here we see that we are justified by the blood. Watch the paragraph. To be justified means to be declared righteous. And God declares us righteous. This verse tells us we are declared righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ. How can this be? To be declared righteous is a one-time legal act which takes place the moment we are saved. We are guilty of sin, and our sin required a payment. The blood of Jesus Christ was shed to pay our sin debt. When we accepted Christ, Jesus Christ as our Savior, our account was stamped, paid in full. It was there that God imputed his righteousness to our account. This is where the justification comes in. Romans 3:22-25 says this, if our righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all, and upon all them that believe, that's imputed righteousness. God gave us his righteousness. He imputed it to us. He put it on our account. He covered us in his righteousness. So there is no difference for us in the nature of the glory of God. All of us need it. All need it. Being justified freely by his grace and the redemption of his name, Christ Jesus, and God set forth the righteousness to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, there it is. He declared his righteousness for the remission of sins, who passed in the forbearance of God. The next one I have there is this. The blood of Jesus Christ satisfied the righteous demands of God, and so it is by his blood that we are justified. That word propitiation then means satisfaction. God set Christ forth to be the satisfaction through faith in his blood. In other words, when Jesus died, when he shed his blood satisfied the righteous demands of God, because God, being holy and righteous, demanded that all sin would be paid for. And so it was paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. And now God can declare you and I righteous because, listen, our whole sin debt so valuable, so precious, and so holy, and so righteous. Moreover, you know this one, the blood provides cleansing. 1 John 1:7. If we walk in the light of season, the light of fellowship with one another, the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son, cleanses us from all sin, present tense. Now, as I love this thought, my first God said, somebody told me this, and I kind of forgot it, that the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed 2,000 years ago was just as powerful today as what it was then. Just as powerful today. Because when a lost sinner comes to Christ, he's washed clean, he's justified, he's redeemed. All that by the blood, all that by the blood. And then you and I, in our daily walk, as we walk in the light of season, and we fellowship with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us, present tense, from all sin. Even today, at completion. We can see from all these verses what God's Word tells us, the blood of Jesus Christ is precious. Who's the shoulder with the disrespect, the blood, the blood is holding up to its proper place of honor. Now, if you, this time goes on, I think you noticed this more, but there were years ago, not too long ago, I remember somebody bringing to my attention that certain Sunday school curriculums, we noticed that we're getting away from the blood. We're getting away from the blood. We got to watch that. We got to be careful. A lot of people don't like the blood. They say Christianity is a bloody religion. So they don't like that. They say, I'm not going to eliminate the blood. I say, without the blood, we don't have hope. Without the blood, we're not redeemed. Without the blood, we're not justified. The blood is vitally important. It is, the Bible tells us that it is precious. It did what God himself cannot do. It redeemed us. The price was paid by the blood of Jesus Christ. So we got to do what we can to uplift and to hold up the blood of Jesus Christ. It is vitally important to our faith. To the gospel of Jesus Christ, vitally important. As I said in the beginning, as you go through the Passover here, we may have more to look at. We haven't even talked about eating the lamb. We're going to get into that next week. But as we go through this, we are reminded over and over again, which maybe you're going to see it as we get to it. We don't get very many details about what happened that night. But boy, we sure get a lot of details about how Israel, what they had to go through to be protected. And the reason for that is because it's a picture of salvation. In Pentecost, as I told you, God wants this in renewed minds. And the Spirit of God presupposes that somebody picks up the Bible and they read it, they come from Exodus 12, and eventually they read in the Gospels. And He wants them to make the connection between the two to help them to see the truth that Christ is the Lamb of God that shed His blood for the sins of the entire world, and in protection from the judgment of God, exemption from the judgment of God comes through the blood of Christ, and that's the only way. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you, Father, for this picture of the Passover Lamb and how it portrays Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for the power that is in the blood. There is life in the blood. Father, that we are redeemed by the blood, that we are justified by the blood, that we are cleansed on a daily basis by the blood. Father, thank you for that precious blood of the Lamb that was shed on our behalf. Father, might we be very alert to make sure that the blood does not get eliminated here at the Christ Bible Church. We're going to be very careful about that. That we uphold the blood, that it does not get trampled underfoot. Father, tonight we just stop and thank you for the forgiveness that comes through Jesus Christ. Even in a broken world, Lord, even in a world that's imploding, so to speak. And Father, there is hope in Christ. something